It was 2016 that the collection and the pamphlets were published. I'm only saying that because certain poems won't make sense if you thought they were published a decade ago. The first poem I'm going to read for you is Wolves, and it seems that most female poets have at least one poem about wolves. She had lived with the wolves till she was three, they said. To her, time was measured only by the period she was with the wolves and what came after. To them, the wolves were unfathomable beasts because they paid homage to the moon with their song and tore at flesh with their precise teeth. But to her, it was them. The men who stared at the flowering teenage girls with the hunt in their eyes, their cold lengths of metal. It was they who were the beasts. So she narrowed her eyes when they spoke to her. And once, when the odoriferous one touched her throat, she turned and made a hole in his cheek with her precise teeth. And she was glad that because she had lived with the wolves, because she spoke few words, and because of her precise teeth, the men never stared at her like that. I can honestly say I've never been preceded by an act such as the last one, which is fantastic. The next poem is from Haunt, the project that was mentioned earlier. And this is based on my own experiences of being vulnerably housed in Harrogate. We've been looking at what it feels to be homeless or vulnerably housed in a place that's supposed to be a place of healing, but isn't for everybody. Dawn wormed its way under our shuttered lids, opening up the pit of the previous night. Problems we went out with, and those with which we returned. Other people's snake-bite secrets, new ones of our own to wheel across our skin and swell our lips. No tea and macaroons or strolls through tree-lined avenues, the branches full of birdsong. Our Sundays were the opened up dog ends and rollies, bedsit gravel and guitar. Even Leeds forever just out of reach. This town has ways of paralysing its young. Occasionally, we would reconfigure their brochures into Moorish roaches, or glimpse their expressions beside the dragonfly buzz of miniature boats. The perfect family, maligned between our drooping gaze and the boating lake. I was involved with a project called Book of Sand, edited by Karen Dennison, and it's inspired by Borges's Book of Sand. It's a sequence of artworks and poems, and all you're given is the work before yours. And although the painting that I was sent in an email was beautiful, I was somewhat dismayed to find that it was a fruit bowl. This is called Secondary School Art. 2 years configured in a fruit bowl. Our placement had to be exact, a Dulux match. I found the relationship between things untranslatable, tried to leave myself out of it. But the mould I had grown blotted the hues of my creation in shameful patina. Miss said my perspective was all wrong, while parts of me rotted dark in corners. My fingerprints showed through the canvas. Later, when the bowl had bled into oblivion, I learned for myself to paint things in different colours, that a puckered pear could at once be a woman, its stalk an umbilical cord to that red of closed eyes on sunstruck days. We kept what was precious cross-hatched behind them. We've become rather used to the language of austerity, and this poem is austerity. Hear it scutter along the guttering of offices, in the bins behind Waitrose, the thorned bushes at the playground's edge. A language devised by the highborn to parch the lips of those with less. Live here too long and it will shudder down your throat like a flu. You will wake one morning, aching with it. All other tongues you know forgotten, the vernacular of the workers, lexicons of children with little, dialects of kindness, the diction of being human. In researching this poem, which is the first in my collection, I found that building materials are often given these beautiful names that almost make them sound like precious stones. So urbanite, as well as being a town or city dweller, is broken up concrete. All they wanted was the drawing in and out of breath. It didn't matter if it was the laughter of children, a businesswoman blowing on a cup of soup, or couples, their groans toppling over one another in an avalanche. They were even grateful for the smack users who pressed their backs against the walls and slipped to the underlay, their size blue pilot lights. And when the yellow jackets came, breathing nicotine and tenorous commands, the houses fell gracefully to gypsum and urbanite, joist and lintel, bequeathed their treasures to the rubble raider, the bone grubber who fingered rusted spoons, picked apart circuit breakers and the exposed arteries of an oven. Loading his spoils on the cart, he sang, and in a timbre of hooves, his horse turned and exhaled, resuscitated ivy and jam. Just going to do a couple more. I wrote this last year for a commission by Bean in Wakefield, and it was the commission was to speak to people from Altofts, which is a mining town in near Wakefield, and the theme is dialect. So this is one man's story. It's called Gibber. Anyone heard of Gibber before? Never let it be said your mother bred a Gibber. He hears the phrase on a hill in Spain, a Barnsley lass calling his laughter back home. A Gibber being a lazy man. I don't like the cut of your jib. Mining lingo. Colin's dad tried for the Navy 3 times, but they needed all the colliers they could get. One more go and we'll lock you up, they said. Colin's origins are in baronry, in knighthoods, Vikings and Egyptian queens. One ancestor photographed with Buffalo Bill, another named for saving a conqueror, Fortesque, strong shield. Then miners. Tom Albert Sharp, the only one who never went down. At 14, his mother dead, left to take care of the kids. 1939, he signs up. You know what happens next. After armistice, bivouacking in the fields, a German takes him in, uses his wife's diamond ring to inscribe a glass, name, date, and unit. Thanks for getting rid of Hitler. Decades on, a small village in France with forgotten name, his nephew finds a photo amongst a pile of relics. Uncle Tom kneels, flower in one hand held out to a little girl, gun in the other. That glass on an Altofts fireplace now. And finally, a short poem. This is Chlorine Attack, Idlib 2014. The second loss of vision is not attributable to smoke. What did they do when the barrel bombs fell, tossing up chalked ground? Did those of Thundercrack away continue to plant sesame seeds, pluck olives from the trees? Was it a warm day? MSN tells us this. Their skins became colanders sifting acid. Organs failing, they burned from the inside. Lungs pumped water to put out the pain. Some of them drowned in it. Nobody took the blame. And what did the dead cities have to say? Did people crouch in Byzantine temples, toddlers bracketed by their bodies? Do the shells shed in limestone ventriloquize their blood-choked words? How much closer must we get to hear them? Thank you for listening.